mechanism of formation of mosaicism is, but more rare, is the meiotic non-disjunction error. This is more rare because it is more complex than mitotic one. It is based on the non-disjunction error that happens usually in the female meiosis and bring to the formation of an abnormal disomic oocyte that, after the fertilization, brings to the formation of a trisomic zygote, and then in a postzygotic phase, there is a second mitotic event, which is called trisomy rescue, which is an attempt to restore back the disomy dosage by eliminating one of the supernumerary chromosomes. This elimination is called the trisomy rescue, and bring to the formation of mosaicism, chromosomal mosaicism between the initial trisomic cell line and the rescued disomic cell line. This mechanism of formation is usually associated with worse clinical outcomes than the mitotic one because it is usually associated with high level of trisomic cells in the term placenta, trisomic cells in the initial mass and therefore in the fetus, and therefore it is associated with an increased risk of congenital abnormalities and uniparental disomy occurrence. This happens when as in this example, the eliminated chromosome during the trisomy rescue is the only chromosome homolog from paternal origin. Therefore, the trisomy rescue brings back the dosage to the disomy, but the two homologous chromosomes derive from the same parent, in this case, from the mother. This situation is of clinical interest when there is an isodisomy, and therefore the reduction to homozygosity of a recessive mutation, therefore this caused the occurrence of a recessive disorder, or it is of clinical interest when the uniparental disomy involves imprinted chromosomes that are chromosome 6, 7, 11, 14, 15, and 20 that are associated, which is associated with the occurrence of imprinting syndromes. The uniparental disomy prevalence is rare at PGTA and spontaneous abortions, less than 1%, while is approximately 4% at prenatal diagnosis on amniotic fluid when there is a mosaic trisomy in the placenta for imprinted chromosomes or a structural abnormality involving an imprinted chromosome. So, as a general consideration, the clinical effect of a chromosomal mosaicism is to attenuate the lethality of a chromosomal aneuploidy because the normal cell line shifts the dosage back towards the normal. However, a precise prediction of the clinical effect of a chromosomal mosaicism is extremely challenging because it depends on various factors, such as the size of the imbalance, the timing of the initial event leading to mosaicism, the effect on syncytial arrest of the abnormality, the distribution of the abnormal cells throughout the various tissues within the body, the ratio of the normal to abnormal cells within each of those tissues, and the occurrence of uniparental disomy. So regarding the incidence of mosaicism in human preimplantation embryos, it depends on the timing of the development. At cleavage stage, it has been reported to be up to 73%, but it drops down to 2 to 5% at the blastocyst stage. For some IVF women preimplantation procedures, the option of for embryo transfer is only a mosaic embryo because they do not produce any euploid embryo. And therefore, different studies are ongoing and have been published regarding the evaluation of the clinical outcomes of a mosaic embryo transfer. Last year, Viotti et al. Published a multicentric retrospective analysis that compared the embryo transfer clinical outcomes of euploid with mosaic blastocysts. And they found that mosaic embryos showed a reduced clinical pregnancy rate, an ongoing reduced ongoing live birth rate, and an increased chance of miscarriage. However, these findings are not uniformly supported by all studies. In fact, there are different confounding factors that affect the detection of a mosaicism in preimplantation embryos. A mathematical model indicates that the analysis of 5 to 10 cells does not provide an accurate representation throughout the whole embryo. In fact, as you can see here, for the same the ability of detecting a mosaicism is dependent on the location of the biopsy, which is completely stochastic. So when for the same mosaic embryo, depending on the location of the biopsy, you can have a wide range of possible results, ranging from completely aneuploid to completely euploid. In addition, there are other factors that all impact the PGT-A copy number algorithms, such as assay noise or artifact, amplification bias, the mitotic stage, the embryology laboratory conditions, and the laboratory threshold sets for calling a mosaicism. Therefore, reporting a mosaic diagnosis may be considered conceptually biased. In order to assess the risk of chromosomal abnormalities in the remaining embryonic portions when a trophoepithelial biopsy is detected to be in a mosaic form, Antonio Capalbo and collaborators performed a study where they investigated the diagnostic concordant rate per chromosome on 73 embryos with 5 biopsies each for a total of 365 multifocal biopsies, including the inner cell mass. They found that low to medium grade mosaicism in one trophoepithelial biopsy reflect a status of highly confined aneuploidy rather than its random distribution throughout the embryo. So they hypothesized, based on these results, that mosaic embryos might have a developmental potential similar to that of euploid ones. To verify this hypothesis, they also ran a multicenter double-blind and prospective and non-selection trial where the embryos showing a low to moderate degree of chromosomal mosaicism were reported back to the women as euploid. And the embryos that were selected for single embryo transfer were selected based on the standard morphological features. They then followed up cases during the post-transfer, prenatal and postnatal periods. They found no evidence that low to medium grade mosaicism affected the pregnancy rate, the miscarriage rate, and the live birth rate. The birth weight and the gestational age at birth were similar between mosaic and euploid embryos. And the genetic investigations that were performed on product of conceptions, ongoing pregnancies, and newborns were all normal except for one case of CPM for trisomy 22. They concluded that these results do not support the cascade of procedures mainly triggered by the detection and reporting of mosaicism in PGT-A testing cases, such as in-depth genetic counseling, invasive procedures, additional genetic testing, and increased anxiety and increased costs. However, there are some considerations that has to be done. First of all, that as clinical consequences of mosaic imbalances may be nuanced and may appear or may appear later in life, clinical evaluation at birth and also long-term developmental clinical evaluation of the babies should be collected. The genetic investigations that have been performed were done on a minor portion of newborns, ongoing pregnancies, and the product of conceptions. And standard cytogenetic and cytogenomic methods were applied. We know that conventional karyotype, above all on chorionic villi samples, or chromosomal microarray alone may not be completely exhaustive in identifying low-level mosaicism, so when there is a suspicion for a mosaicism. Therefore, as I will show you later, an extended workup is usually recommended to increase the confidence of mosaic detection. So this study for sure underlined the urgent need for an international registry of the on the mosaic transfer reproductive and clinical outcomes based on standard clinical and laboratory protocols. So in the meantime, until these aspects are not clarified, physicians and women have to deal with the reporting of mosaic embryo. And therefore, various prioritization models of mosaic embryo transfer have been proposed to guide patients and clinicians dealing with such option. My group, when I was in my previous position, published a scoring system for prioritizing mosaic aneuploid embryo transfer based on the likelihood of various prenatal and postnatal clinical adverse outcomes derived from a review of a large prenatal and miscarriage cytogenetic and uniparental disomy dataset results. They were the likelihood of a true fetal mosaicism when there is a mosaic trisomy in the cytotrophoblast, the so-called confirmation rate, the risk of clinically significant uniparental disomy associated with a trisomy in the placenta, the incidence of mosaicism in product of conception, and the likelihood that a mosaic or homogeneous aneuploidy will lead to a viable affected birth. Therefore, a scoring system for prioritizing mosaic aneuploid embryo transfer was built for any individual mosaic aneuploidy. For each aneuploidy, a composite score of the four adverse outcomes have been built, and the higher the composite score, the lower the priority for embryo transfer. As you can see, there is a great variability of the possible outcomes for any individual aneuploidy, and therefore there is a critical need for genetic counseling for patients in this situation. Patients should be advised before transfer of the risk, benefits, and limitations of various prenatal diagnostic options available to rule out the fetal mosaicism in case-by-case basis. And for patients choosing follow-up prenatal diagnosis, clear communication with the laboratory is crucial so that additional workup, cytogenetic and cytogenomic workup, can be performed as appropriate. So regarding chromosomal mosaicism in prenatal diagnosis, we know that in amniotic fluid there are three different levels of mosaicism. Level 1, when the abnormality is seen in a single cell of a single flask or a single colony for in situ culture. Level 2, when the same abnormality is seen in multiple cells or colonies in a single culture flask or in one in situ culture and not seen in the other independent cultures. And level 3, when the same chromosome abnormality is seen in multiple colonies or cells of multiple independent cultures. Level 3 mosaicism is considered a true fetal mosaicism, and therefore it is usually reported back to women, while level 1 and level 2 are considered pseudomosaicism because in most of the cases are due to cultural artifacts, and therefore they are not usually reported back to women because the likelihood that this kind of mosaicism, pseudomosaicism, is associated with a true fetal mosaicism is extremely low. When we deal with the cytogenetic analysis of chorionic villi samples, we have to admit that the most complete analysis includes a combined approach analyzing both placental layers, the most external one, the cytotrophoblast by direct preparation, and the mesenchymal core by long-term culture. By using this combined approach, in up to 2% of the CVS of the general prenatal population, one chromosomal mosaicism can be detected. depending on the combination of the affected layers by the abnormal cell line, we can identify three different types of mosaicism in the chorionic villi. Type 1, when the abnormality is detected only by direct preparation. Type 2, only by long-term culture. And type 3, when both placental layers show the abnormal cell line together with the normal cell line. Therefore, when one of these mosaicism in the chorionic villi is detected, amniocentesis is the recommended procedure for prenatal confirmation, as the amniotic fluid cells derived from various fetal anatomical organs, but not all anatomical organs, in order to classify the mosaic in the chorionic villi in CPM or TFM. Depending on the combination of the affected layers in the chorionic villi, we can classify CPM as CPM 1, 2, or 3, and TFM of 4, 5, and 6. And the majority of the mosaic in the chorionic villi, almost 87%, are classified as confined placental mosaicism, while 13% of them are classified as true fetal mosaicism. Therefore, depending on the combination of the affected layers, we can have different likelihood of fetal confirmation. The lowest one is associated, or 4% is associated with the combination type 1, while the highest one, almost 40%, is associated with the combination type 3. But there are other factors that affect the likelihood of fetal confirmations. First of all, the mechanism of formation of a mosaic aneuploidy, if mitotic or meiotic, the distribution, mosaic or non-mosaic, of the abnormal cell line within the affected CVS layer, and the specific chromosome and type of abnormality involved. Therefore, when we have a type T distribution, for example, and with an abnormal non-mosaic a non-mosaic abnormality in one of the two layers, here there is an increased risk for a meiotic origin, and therefore an increased risk for fetal trisomies and uniparental disomy. Therefore, combining all these factors, we can have variable fetal confirmation risks that are associated with individual mosaic abnormalities. And for example, rare autosomal trisomies that are trisomies from chromosome 1 to chromosome 22 except trisomy 13, 18, and 21 show a very unique pattern of fetal confirmation. It is the lowest one, the lowest one, which is 3%, and when a rare autosomal trisomy is detected to be a true fetal mosaicism in the amniotic fluid, the karyotype is always in a mosaic form. Otherwise, a karyotype in a homogeneous form would be incompatible and lethal, and therefore that would cause a very early miscarriage. Therefore, when we have a mosaic in the chorionic villi, the presence of an ultrasound scan abnormality is often an indicator of a true fetal mosaicism. However, the absence of ultrasound scan abnormalities does not completely eliminate the chance of a true fetal mosaicism or later clinical consequences. And therefore, the follow-up studies should include a high-resolution ultrasound scan to assess the fetal morphology, and an amniocentesis with a high cell count number when there is a normal karyotype with standard analysis. So it is crucial that the laboratory should be made aware of the CVS result in order to set the appropriate management of the amniotic fluid sample and planning the specific testing, such as an increased cell count or appropriate interface fish studies with a higher degree of confidence, The direct, for example, the direct analysis of uncultured amniocytes by FISH analysis or CMA for trisomies that show a growth disadvantage in cultured amniotic fluid cell lines, for example, for trisomy 8 or trisomy 20, and the uniparental disomy testing when the trisomy involves an imprinted chromosome. So, the presence of an abnormal mosaic karyotype in amniotic fluid poses a diagnosis of a true fetal mosaicism. However, it does not necessarily guarantee a poor outcome, as the phenotype depends on the level of the abnormal cells and its distribution in the critical tissues, such as brain, heart, and others. A normal karyotype in the amniotic fluid usually places a diagnosis of confined placental mosaicism. However, a true fetal mosaicism can never be ruled out with 100% certainty because a risk of 10% of cryptic mosaicism should be taken into consideration. Cryptic mosaicism that can be in other tissues, fetal tissues that are not represented in amniotic fluid, or that disappears during the growth culture. The presence of ultrasound scan abnormalities usually is a suspicion for cryptic mosaicism in other tissues, as it happens for CPM for trisomy 16 with the congenital anomalies. Essentially, unless ultrasound scan abnormalities are evident in the fetus, a precise prediction about the prognosis in individual cases are not possible. A special consideration should be performed for CPM for trisomy 16 because this condition prompts a special clinical management. This condition is associated with the risk of fetal malformations, intrauterine demise, IUGR, preeclampsia, and preterm delivery, and therefore serial ultrasound scan monitoring the fetal growth are appropriate. However, a Danish study reported that in 32% of the babies born with a CPM for trisomy 16, there was a normal birth weight and no malformations. And in another study, including both CPM for trisomy 16 and TFM, there was a significantly higher incidence of congenital anomalies for CPMs compared to TFM compared to CPM. But most children, both CPM and TFM, had normal neurodevelopmental outcome and high health-related quality of life scores. So regarding cell-free DNA test, NIPT using cell-free DNA test, we have to remember that the result of this test reflects the genetic constitution of the cytotrophoblast and not of the fetus itself. Therefore, the presence of fetoplacental mosaicism affecting the embryo that is under investigation is a major source of discordant false positive in case of CPM1 or CPM3, or false negative results in case of a true fetal mosaicism type 5. Therefore, because the high-risk result can be due either to a full aneuploidy or to a mosaic aneuploidy in the cytotrophoblast, then a confirmatory testing, diagnostic testing, is usually recommended to confirm this abnormality. When we consider chorionic villi sampling as a confirmatory invasive procedure, we have also to take into consideration the likelihood of finding a mosaicism in the chorionic villi, and therefore the need for a subsequent confirmatory amniocentesis. This risk depends on the type of chromosomal aneuploidy and also on the ultrasound scan findings. It may range from 2% for trisomies 21, regardless of the ultrasound scan findings, to 70% for monosomy X in association with normal ultrasound findings. So special consideration should be done for results with an IPT indicating a rare autosomal trisomy. This kind of finding can be detectable only by genome-wide NIPT only, and they are considered the so-called additional findings. There are three different primary outcomes that can follow the detection of a rat in cell-free DNA. The presence of a confined placental mosaicism, which is the most likely one. The presence of a miscarriage, and this happens when there is a high proportion of cells in the conceptus. And the presence of a mosaic rat confirmed in the second trimester amniotic fluid. This condition is associated with variable clinical outcomes ranging from normal to severely affected. The challenge comes with the inability to accurately predict which of the three outcomes will prevail for each specific rat identified by the NIPT and predict the risks in individual cases. A systematic review of the clinical outcome of high-risk results for rat identified by the NIPT and reported in papers showed that there are variable incidence of individual outcomes between the different studies. These outcomes were early miscarriage, true fetal mosaicism, abnormal phenotype, clinically significant uniparental disomy for imprinted chromosomes, IUGR. This variable incidence between studies is due to confounding factors that are present in the structure of the studies, such as the incomplete follow-up, variable protocols for follow-up, including the phone call, ranging from the phone call at home to genetic testing, and differences in the reasons for test referral, the so-called a priori risk. The adverse outcome rates that were detected are probably an overestimate, as cases receiving follow-up studies probably represented those at highest risks. Essentially, this study showed that the rat identified in cell-free DNA have uncertain risks for fetal loss, growth restriction, and fetal abnormalities, and that the genome-wide test is not an efficient screening for fetal anomalies and pregnancy complications. Another study was run to explore the association between CPM for rare autosomal trisomies detected in chorionic villi samples and adverse pregnancy outcomes. This is a follow-up retrospective study based on medical record review of CPM cases for rats diagnosed with a combined cytogenetic approach, analyzing both placental layers. The study showed that most CPM for rats, excluding trisomy 16, the general health of the mother and the fetus can be expected to be close to that seen for pregnancies with normal chorionic villi karyotype. As in agreement with the literature, only CPM for trisomy 16 showed a markedly increased for adverse outcomes. Therefore, assuming similar performances of CVS, cytogenetic analysis, and genome-wide and IPT, the screening for rats is unlikely to be an effective screening for fetal growth restriction. Last week, a study reporting clinical outcomes of additional findings with genome-wide NIPT in Trident 2 study has been published. This is an interventional prospective nationwide study aimed at investigating the clinical significance of these additional findings, including rare autosomal trisomies. They concluded that most of the additional findings confirmed in the fetus as a true fetal mosaicism are pathogenic and associated with severe clinical phenotypes. CPM for rats are significantly associated with adverse perinatal outcomes required a tailored obstetric care, and the author suggested to use low-dose aspirin. However, again, there are some considerations to do about this study. First of all, that the pathogenicity of confirmed mosaic rat in the fetus has been assigned assuming that any true fetal mosaic for rat is clinically significant, as we have seen, this is not applicable in all cases. The detection of a CPM for rat apparently increases the risk for fetal abnormalities or pregnancy complications. However, for any specific rat, even those that they found, the authors found, at an increased risk, the extent of this risk is not sufficiently defined. The authors suggest aspirin, but there is no data demonstrating the benefit for this particular subgroup of women, those that have a preeclampsia due to a confined placental mosaicism. This is, and finally, an unblinded study, and therefore at risk for Hachette-Mame bias, because the perinatal outcomes and genetic results are determined by the same healthcare providers that offer the genome-wide NIPT. Therefore, even after this study, the pretest counseling remains not possible or vague. Counsel for rats, pretense counsel for rats as an aggregate group is not possible. Post-test counseling in cases without fetal abnormalities is not possible, and for any particular woman, there is still no way to predict the risks since they depend on the distribution of the trisomic cells in fetal and placental tissues. Therefore, the results of this study further reiterate the urgent need for a randomized control trial to finally establish the clinical relevance of reporting rats in cell-free DNA. Finally, an IPT based on isolated circulating trophoblast in maternal blood, the so-called cell-based NIPT. With this test, as for any test based on the analysis of cytotrophoblast, fetoplacental mosaicisms are confounding factors. Therefore, as for cytogenetic analysis, the statistical confidence of mosaic exclusion depends on the number of analyzed cells. And it is possible to detect discordant results as for cytogenetics or cell-free DNA test. However, with cell-based NIPT, the mosaicism cases can be identified based on single-cell analysis, while for cell-free DNA test, it is the way to predict if a high-risk result is due to a full aneuploidy or a mosaic aneuploidy is not completely reliable. Fully discordant results, in addition, with the fetal karyotype are also expected. Like when cytogenetic analysis is based only on cytotrophoblast, we have to expect cases that show an abnormal non-mosaic cytotrophoblast and normal amniocentesis. That these cases are the so-called false discoveries. And cases that show no abnormality in cytotrophoblasts, but abnormality in amniocentesis. And these cases are called false omissions. While the false omission rate is low, 0.09%, and extremely low for trisomy 21, 18, and 13, therefore, this type of test can be considered reliable for excluding at least common trisomies, the false discovery rate is high, 8%, and particularly high for trisomy 13, monosomy X, rare autosomal trisomies, and large segmental imbalances. Therefore, because the high chance that a normal fetal karyotype when a homogeneous monosomy X trisomy 13, rare autosomal trisomy, and large segmental imbalances detected in all amniocytes, the finding should be confirmed with ultrasound scan investigations for monosomy X and trisomy 13, and with amniocentesis for rats and large segmental imbalances, and even for trisomy 13 and monosomy X if no ultrasound scan abnormalities are detected. So, in conclusion, in preimplantation genetic testing, it is crucial to standardize criteria for detecting and reporting chromosomal mosaicisms, to establish an international registry on the mosaic transfer reproductive and clinical outcomes based on standard protocols, and to clarify if chromosomal mosaicisms at PGATA correspond to those detected in prenatal diagnosis, first trimester prenatal diagnosis, above all those of mitotic origin. The clinical significance of a mosaicism in prenatal diagnosis setting is well recognized, and rather than refer to it as a variant of unclear significance, we should approach mosaicism as a variant of uncertain outcome. For this reason, the clinical utility of actively investigating and reporting these variants in screening frameworks such as the cell-free DNA testing is highly controversial. Our ability in prenatal diagnosis of the clinical impact is guided by the time of ascertainment and then by the result of follow-up procedures such as ultrasound scan and amniocentesis. Ultimately, unless we biopsy every major fetal tissue and in absence of apparent fetal abnormalities, the prenatal finding of hemosacism will remain a variant of uncertain outcome. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for the great talk. Questions? All that are in present, please approach the microphone, and all online, you can also set the questions. Yes, please. Just wait a minute, I think. Somewhere is coming.
Domenico Coviello, Genova, Italy. Thank you very much for your presentation, and I see that after all the questions that you posed, you propose a registry.
Yep.
So the main question is, do you have already in mind, or there is somebody who is working for this registry? Can this registry can start as soon as possible? Because this is quite important. This is one of the messages that you gave in the end. Thank you.
When I went at some preimplantation congresses, for example, COGEN, a couple of years ago before the pandemic, there was the proposal of doing such kind of registry. But something happened in these 2 years, in the last 2 years, and I don't know if this project moved forward, but for sure this is the world of preimplantation diagnosis knows that this is a priority.
Thank you.
There's an online question by Roman Litvinenko asking, what is the accuracy quantity of trophoectodermal biopsied cells for adequate defining of mosaicism with PGT-A?
I know that there is not, during PGT-A, the maximum number of cells that can be picked up is 10, as far as I know. I don't know if this is a good number, but I think from mathematical models, this is not a number that allows to be sure to detect mosaicism or to be sure to, to exclude mosaicism. The study of Antonio Capalbo showed that unless you biopsy all the embryo, you cannot be sure, 100% sure of the detection of the of the karyotype of the fetus, of the embryo.
Yeah, that's really the problem.
Yeah.
He also said when we want to confirm the mosaicism on amniotic fluid,
yeah,
would you prefer to do fish on uncultured, or would you go for array CGH? What's the sensitivity of these two methods? What do you think is better?
In my previous position, we usually manage the amniocentesis sample depending on the chromosome that is involved in the mosaicism. And usually we make a direct analysis of the amniocytes by chromosomal microarray when there is a trisomy that can disappear during grow culture, for example. Trisomy 8 or trisomy 20. This is something that we take into consideration, but in general, what we do is increase the number of cells, counted cells, and the number of clones in independent cultures. We try to extend obviously we cannot, I mean, there is a certain balance between the cost and effectiveness, and I mean, at a certain point we stop and we arrive at least 50, to analyze 50 metaphases spread, at least from three independent cultures.
Mm-hmm. And the last question.
Thank you. Alain Go, Thermo Fisher Scientific. Do you think the cell-based NIPT from fetal cells from the cervix could be better than from the blood?
I mean, there are not head-to-head comparisons between the different methods because they are pretty new methods. I think that the contamination would be the same. I think that there is the unique problem to me is the willingness of the woman to do a sampling of the cervix during the pregnancy versus blood sampling. Someone say that this is just similar to a pap test, which I don't think it's completely the same, because I think it is more invasive. But I mean, I'm curious to see, I mean, future studies and future validation studies regarding the level of contamination of maternal contamination with this type of sampling.
Thank you, Dr. Grati. And now-